Pleasure to introduce Cliff Sloan and also a treat to look forward to his remarks today. Cliff is currently Vice President for Business Development and General Counsel at Washington Post Newsweek Interactive, which, as you probably know, is responsible for bringing you Washington Post Online, Newsweek, and as of a year ago, Slate Online. And Cliff's also the publisher of Slate. I met him when he was working in the White House Counsel's office back in the 90s, and I was at the Department of Justice. Prior to then, Cliff clerked for Justice Stevens, was an assistant to the Solicitor General in the Department of Justice, and argued, five Supreme Court cases. And before that, had spent some time as the associate independent counsel in the Iran-Contra investigation. So he's had a very interesting career in addition to some time in private practice. Currently, and the reason that he's here today, he's involved in internet journalism, and that's the topic, as well as other developments in the internet, and that's the topic he's going to talk about today. He's here with his son, Nick, who's over here doing his homework, multitasking. The presence of Nick and the timing of the Maryland-Duke basketball game tonight is not entirely coincidental, and it's a delight to have Cliff here. So Cliff's going to talk for 20 minutes or so, and he says interrupt him with questions, but then we'll go to a question and answer session afterwards.
Right, exactly. Thanks very much. It's great to be here. And as Chris was saying, I will definitely save time for question and answer. But please, if there's a question, a comment, a thought that you want to express, you know, as we're going along, feel free any time to jump in. And this is a great time to be talking and thinking about online journalism, the future of online journalism, the future of quality journalism online, because in the editorial area, in the business area, and in the legal area, it's a time when there are many fundamental issues that are bubbling, and the kind of future course of it is really going to be set to a large extent in the next year or two, I think, at least in some fundamental ways. And it's one of these amazing times where there's a tremendous amount that's up for grabs. Some people are very worried about it. Some people are very excited about it. Some people are very confused about it. And so let me just try to give you a little bit the lay of the land as I see it, flag the issues that are there, and we'll talk about it. Before I get started, I want to ask one question. I'm just curious. How many people in this room regularly go online for news and information? Okay, so pretty much everybody. Okay, how many people in this room regularly read a print newspaper? Okay, so probably less than half. If we had asked that question 5 years ago, I think there would be radically different responses. In a nutshell, that's part of the issue right now, that people are both excited about, some people worried about, and people spending a lot of time thinking about it. As I said, let me tell you the lay of the land as I see it in terms of the editorial issues, the business issues, and the legal issues. To do that, let me just start by telling you a little bit more about where I am, what I do, in terms of the sites that Chris mentioned, both because that, to some extent, is my frame of reference and my experience, and because I think actually with those sites, you'll see some interesting differences and comparisons. Well, let's start with Slate, which is online only. As Chris was mentioning, the Washington Post Company bought Slate from Microsoft about a year ago. It was launched as a big online journalism experiment in 96. Microsoft was able to get Michael Kinsley, a very well-known editor of the New Republic, and he had been the editor of Harper's, to come and be the founding editor, which immediately gave it credibility and legitimacy, and he was able to get a lot of big names to write for Slate. Slate had a lot of twists and turns. It'll be the 10th anniversary in June. But again, Slate is online only. We call it a daily magazine. It's 15 to 20 stories a day, Monday through Friday. We've got about 8 or 9 million users a month. We've got about 55 to 60 million page views per month. And those are, in the online publishing business, those are two of the most important metrics: the number of users you have and the number of pages that those users actually view. So Slate is a great perspective on of the kind of online-only publication. We have WashingtonPost.com, which is the online arm and engine of the Washington Post. WashingtonPost.com gets about 12 to 15 million users a month, about 200 to 220 million page views a month. And WashingtonPost.com, there are a lot of interesting developments, particularly for an organization whose roots are on the print side and whose identity was shaped on the print side. A lot of very exciting things going on right now. You know, people have traditionally talked about publications on the web being, you know, this is the Washington Post on the web. And one of the things that's become a very big thing for WashingtonPost.com and the other sites is figuring out how to be of the web as much as possible, how to take advantage of the medium as much as possible. We'll get back to some of the issues about WashingtonPost.com and both some of the opportunities and some of the challenges. We also have Newsweek.com. So again, the online sibling or engine of a print publication. Now here, you know, Newsweek, the national news weeklies developed in the 30s, the idea that, you know, you get the issue on the Monday and it gives you your perspective on the week. Newsweek and Time and U.S. News themselves have evolved over time. If you look at issues from the 30s, the 40s, the 50s, they were very literally summarizing the news for people. This is what happened on Monday. This is what happened on Tuesday. And as you get into the more recent times, increasingly, the idea has been that it's putting a perspective on the week for you. You may have heard about what's going on, but it's putting it in an analytical framework. It's giving a distinctive take to it. But again, until the last few years, distinctively on a weekly schedule. Now, Newsweek.com is an ongoing site. There's a lot of web original content. There are different themes on it every day in an effort to get people to come to it as part of their regular online habits. Newsweek has, Newsweek.com, if I haven't said this, has about 7 million monthly users and has about 30 to 35 million page views per month. With Newsweek, we have a relationship, a partnership with MSNBC that's about 5 years old, where Newsweek is actually housed within MSNBC. There are different characteristics of that in terms of not being a freestanding site in the way that WashingtonPost.com and Slate is. We also have a travel site because Newsweek owns Arthur Frommer's Budget Travel magazine. And so they have a site, budgettravelonline.com, which was on MSNBC since June. It's been a freestanding site. It's different from the other three news and information sites because it's in this category of travel. And I'm going to basically kind of leave that to one side unless anybody wants to talk about that, because that's a very different enterprise in a lot of ways. That has about 250 to 300,000 users per month right now, and it gets about 1 million page views. Very focused on travel. I have really three hats with Washington Post Newsweek Interactive. One of them is publisher of Slate, so overseeing all of the operations of Slate, the business side, working very closely with the editor and the folks on the editorial side. I'm the general counsel, so all of the legal issues for all of our properties and everything from contracts to intellectual property issues to First Amendment and content issues, and on and on, comes through our office, the general counsel's office. Parenthetically, the Washington Post company tends to be a fairly decentralized company. Most media companies would have one central legal staff and maybe one person specializing in intellectual property, and they would be at corporate headquarters. The Washington Post company and our CEO, Don Graham, are big believers in pushing people and authority out to the individual operating units with the idea that you're immersed in the business, that I'm, as the general counsel of Washington Post Newsweek Interactive, I'm living in the online world with the online editors, with the online business people, and that you can actually do a much better job if you're much more integrated with the operating unit. And then I also am vice president of business affairs. I've been vice president of business development. It's different kind of general business activities on behalf of all three. So let me, as I was mentioning, go through a little bit about the editorial side, the business side, and the legal side, and some of the issues that are happening right now. Now, from an editorial perspective, online journalism, there are some things that are fundamentally different from the offline world, from the print world. And let me go through what I think are some of the big characteristics. And these have a profound impact on the daily DNA of the publication, and also on the public policy side of it, on the people that we're interacting with, because things are really in a somewhat different environment. I say somewhat different because some of the characteristics, as I'll go through, are very different. On the other hand, you know, people from the Washington Post Company would emphasize that some of the basic journalistic values are the same and have to remain the same, whether you're online or offline or in any medium. But the first one is simply the speed and the radical effect on the news cycle. You know, I mentioned that Slate is a daily magazine, just for example, with 15 to 20 stories a day. I was on a panel for the Magazine Publishers Association in June. Everybody else there was from magazines, and they were talking about, from print magazines, talking about their online activities. And as we went down the line talking about what we did, when I had this description of a daily magazine, for the magazine world, that blew people's minds. That description, a daily magazine, seemed to people to be almost antithetical to their idea of what a magazine is. You look at the newspaper rhythm with the Washington Post, where for a long time it's been preparing something for the next day's edition, working on it, you got to file it by such and such a time, and people were working on the story for the next day, and everybody was very used to that. And of course, right now, speed is of the essence. Whether you're talking about Slate, WashingtonPost.com, Newsweek.com, breaking stories online, getting not only the breaking news stories, but the analysis and the take on it out there right away is critically important. Sometimes it's debated whether that's a good thing or not. Somebody who was the ombudsman for the Washington Post used to write about, well, here are all these reporters filing stories during the day, getting them up on the website. Is that taking away from their time spent reporting because they're in this kind of, you know, cycle of getting something out right away? Of course, you know, newspaper fans and people who know newspaper history will remember that there used to be this kind of round-the-clock extra, read all about it with a new edition when there was a breaking story. But there are some very interesting questions about what that does to the reporting cycle. And it's an incredible thing. And you hear people say all the time, you probably experienced this, that sometimes when they get their print newspaper the next day, a lot of the news feels like, well, I already know that because you've been reading it all day online. Yesterday during the Alito hearings, there's a guy at the Washington Post, Fred Barbash, who previously has been the Supreme Court reporter and focuses on online for the Washington Post, who was blogging, doing a running commentary during the Alito hearing, and you would get a synopsis with his take on it on every senator's questions within minutes of the senator finishing the question. So the whole question of speed is a very interesting question. And you know, one of the things that a lot of the reporters, especially ones say on WashingtonPost.com, will tell you is that they have found that in a lot of cases, getting a story up there early, they can get reactions to it, which are actually very helpful to them as they continue to work the story. But so speed is a fundamental change. You know, on the other hand, I talked about the journalistic values, and the guy who was executive editor of WashingtonPost.com until this past January, who had spent a lot of time at the newspaper, used to love to say, it's more important to get it right than to be the first ones to get it. And he would try to uphold that value. At the same time, I have to tell you, you can't imagine the competitive pressures as other sites are getting news up there to be as fast as or faster than the competitors. So how you balance those things of the important, those different values of the important journalistic values and the premium on speed, I think is an interesting question. Okay, second, blogs and the phenomenon of blogs. You know, I was reading something today that the current estimate is that there are 24 million blogs out there. Now, you know, obviously there's a much smaller group that is having a major impact, I think, that are kind of widely read. There's a kind of cluster, and then it, you know, kind of trails off. But I think it's significant in a couple of different respects, because first of all, I think the blogs have brought a very intense focus on the media and on public policy with a kind of distinctive perspective. You know, people try to set it up as a conflict between blogs and mainstream media, and a kind of fight to the death between them. And in fact, I think blogs, the blogging phenomenon, I think has been enormously helpful to mainstream media for a couple of reasons. I mean, first of all, they spend an incredible amount of time and energy and insight focusing on the content of the mainstream media. Now, that's good in a couple of ways. First of all, it's good because of the scrutiny, because it does make people stay on their toes, and I think that's a very, very good thing. But it's also good because it's never been more important. I mean, Washington, let me give you an example. People talk about declining circulation, and it's true, and almost every newspaper has declining circulation, and that poses huge issues. But it is also true that far more people than ever before are reading Washington Post journalism, are reading New York Times journalism, and the blogs and the blogging phenomenon and the care about issues that goes into that helps very much to feed that. In terms of the media, just in terms of the kind of scrutiny and the attention, I think that blogs are very helpful, and it's actually the same project in a way in terms of kind of thinking about public policy. But the other thing is that mainstream media outlets are embracing blogging. You know, I mentioned the Fred Barbash blogging about the Supreme Court hearings. There's probably 20 to 30 blogs on WashingtonPost.com right now. Slate, Mickey Kaus's blog was one of the very first blogs. It's a very popular feature on Slate. There are other blogs on Slate. WashingtonPost.com and Newsweek.com did these deals earlier this year with Technorati, which is a search engine for blogs, where when you read a story on WashingtonPost.com, there's a box from Technorati where you can find any blog that's commenting on it. And there's no kind of filtering that, you know, it's only positive things and it wouldn't be there if it's a negative thing. It's the Technorati search engine, anybody that's blogging on it. Now, you know, I have to tell you, I mean, there are some people in a traditional media perspective who say, why are we doing this? You know, this is our content. We should present it the way we want to. Why are we at the same time kind of having an equal doorway to what everybody in the world is saying about it? But we as publications and as a company have gone very much in the other direction of welcoming and trying to embrace that dialogue with the blogs. Now, the other thing I want to mention is that, you know, I said there's this kind of small cluster that gets the most attention. There's a feature on Slate called Today's Blogs that surveys the most read. Chris and I were talking about there are people on is it on CNN or MSNBC, maybe both, who report on what's on the blogs. But at the same time, you know, think about that fact of 24 million blogs, and even somebody who's not being read. The whole lack of a barrier to entry, the whole accessibility of the medium, really is a return to the kind of pamphleteer of Tom Paine's day in a way that we haven't seen in a very long time. So, I mean, that's another, I think, very, very positive impact of the blogs and the kind of democracy of the internet in that sense. Okay, a third characteristic that is very important editorially is the accessibility of the web, that you can get it any place, any time. And again, let me give you the Washington Post and WashingtonPost.com as an example of that. You know, the Washington Post unlike the New York Times, consistently has refused to have national or international print distribution of the newspaper. And why? For a couple reasons. First of all, it's very expensive, actually, to distribute a publication nationally. You've got to get them on trucks or airplanes. You've got to get them so that they can be in this kind of vast network. I mean, that's one reason. I think another reason is that the Washington Post, as a newspaper, has always felt very strongly that it has a local constituency, and being the dominant local paper in the Washington area is very important to its identity. But with the web, with WashingtonPost.com, of course, it's available nationally and internationally. And one thing that has happened, and it's happened almost from the start with very little effort, is that there is an enormous national and international audience for Washington Post journalism. That didn't happen and couldn't happen before, I mean, WashingtonPost.com launched 10 years ago. Before that, it was impossible. You know, it was very difficult to get it. 85% of the users on WashingtonPost.com are from outside the DC area, are people who could not get a print version of the Washington Post newspaper. We have as many users in California as we do in Maryland, and I could give you a lot of other facts about that. But that's a very, very interesting question journalistically and editorially in terms of kind of how we're serving this huge constituency in California who are coming there to it, what's emphasized on the homepage, and that kind of thing. So the universal accessibility is very important from an editorial perspective. The ability to have multimedia, which obviously by definition you can't have in print. Let me give you just a couple of examples of this. On WashingtonPost.com, there's this small video unit. It's about four or five people who've been doing these short documentary videos for the last few years. And these videos have been, they're terrific, and they've been sweeping the White House News Photographers Association Awards every year, not in the internet category, but against the networks and against the BBC, because the networks and other places are not putting the resources into a kind of 10-minute documentary on an issue or something like that. And, you know, we repeatedly over the last few years have won, you know, best cameraman of the year, best editor of the year. It was the same person, which would never happen, you know, at a network where you would have like 50 people responsible for each of those functions. But it's a great example of the potential of the medium and of a different kind of storytelling that's available. Slate just entered a deal with Magnum Photos. Magnum Photos, you know, is this legendary cooperative of photographers that was formed right after World War II, that every kind of iconic image of a documentary photo that you can imagine in the last 50 to 60 years came from Magnum. And we are ultimately making the whole Magnum archive available through Slate. We're having daily themes each day that highlight different themes from the Magnum archive. But we have the opportunity to do that, and we don't have some of the limitations of space that you would have in a print publication. There are other examples of multimedia as well, but let me leave it at that for right now. You know, the opportunity for interactivity, whether it's the ability to engage in discussions. On Slate, there's a very, very active discussion area called The Fray, and we have somebody who writes a column about the best comments in The Fray. We have a system where star posters in The Fray, the people who write the best comments, as deemed by our Fray editor, get special posting privileges that aren't available to everybody else. There's a kind of special area that anybody can read, but the star posters are the only ones who can post there. But it's a very, very active area on the site. On WashingtonPost.com, we're in the process of adding the opportunity for people to add comments to any article that they read. Just post the article right there. Know what I was saying about Technorati? And the idea of just kind of opening it up to the blogger's comments when there's an article. We're doing the same thing with user comments on WashingtonPost.com. Something that's getting a lot of comment and interest is citizen journalism. You know, for example, in the London subway bombings, people sent in pictures and videos from their cell phone to the BBC and to some of the other kind of television outlets. And a lot of media companies are experimenting with this and how to get kind of citizen reports of their community. And it's something that people are, there's a lot of ferment going on with that right now. And the last thing that I think is really important editorially is just delivery, how you deliver it. Two examples are podcast and on wireless. And one, I think, podcast, unexpected success. Wireless is the kind of next big thing that never really develops in terms of being a big thing, unlike in Europe, where people are much, much more attuned to, and in Asia, where they're much, much more attuned to getting news, you know, on their cell phone and using it regularly. The adoption rate for that in the U.S. has remained low, even though there are always great expectations with it. On the other hand, with podcasts, just kind of out of nowhere, with the success of iTunes, different entities started podcasting discussions, articles, that kind of thing. We did it on Slate just saying, well, let's put it out there and see what happens. It quickly became one of the most downloaded podcasts in the non-music area on iTunes. I mean, it was literally at the top of the charts there. And it has spurred a lot of thinking about how to deliver content on iPods and similar devices. So it's just an example of how some of the things that you don't expect in terms of new delivery vehicles all of a sudden become, you know, somewhat exciting new delivery vehicles. And let me talk a little bit about the business side, which is both a fantastic opportunity and a tremendous challenge. In terms of the opportunity, let me just kind of give you my bird's eye view of what's happened in the last several years. You know, there was the internet bubble, and there was all this money going to internet advertising, as everybody knows and remembers. And a lot of it was kind of crazy money that people were pumping into it. And then there was the bubble, and then everybody was like, oh, the internet's not going to work. That was all kind of bad money. And then one of the things that happened in the last 2 to 3 years is that it became a settled proposition for mainstream companies and mainstream advertising agencies that you need to have online advertising as part of your overall advertising mix, and not about clicks to your site or that kind of thing, but from an advertiser's perspective, as a way of getting your message across, just like you're trying to do with any ads. And the big fight now is how much of your budget should go into online compared to other things. But you name it, every sector, every mainstream company, every mainstream advertising agency is devoting a tremendous amount to online advertising, and they are especially interested in quality sites that have a quality audience, which are ones that they want to reach. Now, that's been very good for us and for our business. In 2004, as stated in the post-annual report, our subsidiary, we brought in $62 million in revenue. We were profitable for the first time. That was up 32% from 2003. We've reported on the first three quarters of this year, and our revenue's been up 24% for the first 9 months of 2005. And there's a tremendous amount of energy going on there. You know, I happen to be reading, because with my business hats now, this is a very important thing to read, Adweek, on the way down here, which is one of the Bibles of the advertising industry. And it was looking ahead to 2006, and just as an example, in the course of an article about 2006, they say, a few things are clear as we head into 2006. For one, most observers expect the medium to have another terrific year following a 2005 that took in an estimated $12 billion in ad revenue. As marketers continue to shift spending from traditional to digital media, experts expect spending to surge between 20% and 30% this year. I mean, this is the kind of establishment, you know, organ of the advertising industry, and it tells you something about what's going on there. It's very, very competitive, you know, for sites in terms of trying to get that online advertising dollars, but there's no question that that's happening, and it's accelerating every year. But it's also a huge challenge, because take the Washington Post newspaper. I mean, as I mentioned, we brought in $62 million in 2004. To support the Washington Post newsroom, it takes several hundred million dollars a year. So if in terms of thinking about the kind of quality journalism that goes into something like the Washington Post Enterprise, whether it's online or offline, it's great that business has been picking up a lot for us. We still have a long way to go in figuring out that business model. A lot of people are worried on the print side because of the declining readership, the shifting habits. The newspaper, however, still brings in several hundred million dollars in advertising. So it's an interesting issue, challenge, opportunity in terms of online advertising. Online advertising has some great advantages, which is the reason for that trend that I read about, I quoted in Adweek. I mentioned the quality audience. I mentioned the opportunity of getting brand advertising there. But there are some unique things about online advertising. You can reach people during the day and at work in a way that you can't with any other medium. You reach people on task at their computer screen. An advertiser generally only pays for advertising on the kinds of sites we're talking about if an impression appears on somebody's screen. So it's not where there's a commercial and you either TiVo through it or you get up to get a beer or you switch the channel. It appears on somebody's screen and while they're focused on task. You can target in different ways. You can target according to content. You can target according to where somebody is from. And you can do that whether you're a site that requires registration, like WashingtonPost.com does, or whether you're a site that doesn't require registration, such as Slate. If you are a site that requires registration, like WashingtonPost.com or the New York Times, you can also target according to gender. You can target according to age. And those kinds of things are very important to advertisers. And we can talk about that. We can talk about that more. But it's also true that one of the fundamental changes, or one of the fundamental challenges, has to do with one of the changes in the way people get news and information. Somebody who I used to work with loved to say that the web disaggregates what was aggregated and aggregates what was disaggregated. And I think that's a very important insight. Because what he was saying, in terms of disaggregating what was aggregated, you take a newspaper, it's a great invention. You've got the front section, you've got a section maybe on food, on cars, on sports, you've got coverage of movies. It's all in one newspaper. You go online, and for sports, I mean, maybe you could see WashingtonPost.com, either about sports generally or the Redskins, but you can also go to ESPN.com, you can go to CBSSportsLine.com, and you name any area, and you've got sites focusing just in that, whether it's politics, whether it's job listings, historically a really important source of revenue for newspapers, whether it's movies, whether it's music, on down the line. So completely disaggregates the information in that sense. You can pick and choose what you want from WashingtonPost.com, what you want from here, what you want from here. That's got some very profound business implications. At the same time, it also aggregates what was disaggregated in the sense that there are sites that put lots of different pieces together based on an experience, whether you're buying a home or a car or something like that. You can, on one site, do everything you want to do, whether it's check out insurance, whether it's a comparative shop, whether it's actually consummate the transaction right there. Something that would take maybe six different steps and checking in different places, you can do that all in one place. Both of those characteristics fundamentally change the business proposition for print publications moving forward. And the last thing, just to kind of flag some of the legal issues that I think are kind of most dominant right now, let me tell you a little bit about my background. As Chris was mentioning, after I was at the White House Counsel's office, I was back in practice, and I had an appellate and legal issues practice, and I got involved in some of the early internet law cases, including a First Amendment case that went to the Supreme Court, the Communications Decency Act case. And one of the things that struck me, and this was in 96, was that it was very unusual to have a situation where you had a legal regime where many of the most fundamental questions were up for grabs. And so I started to get much more immersed in that, both in my practice, in teaching it as the whole subject of internet law as an adjunct. I have to say that almost 10 years later, I still think a lot of the fundamental questions are still up for grabs, and it's still very interesting. And there are new questions that have come up. Just to flag some of the questions that I see as kind of big ones on the horizon to think about as legal issues with the future of online journalism. One of them is this whole question of net neutrality, and there are bills in Congress about this right now. You know, the assumption has been in the last several years, and the federal policy has been, that the providers of the connectivity, such as your broadband provider, would be neutral about the content flowing through it. So, so if you have XYZ broadband company, they're not going to favor WashingtonPost.com and disadvantage the New York Times site or anything like that, that there's an assumption of kind of equal access. And for that matter, you know, same thing goes for the individual pamphleteer blogger, that it's really, you know, sometimes people say dumb pipes, you know, that it's just that it's providing connectivity, but it's not favoring or disfavoring one or the other. There have been some people in the online industry who have been worried that that might change. You know, Barry Diller, who's at the Interactive Corporation and who's on the Washington Post Company board, has been worried for a while because he saw in cable where disfavored cable channels would be given, very unattractive channel numbers that nobody ever went to. So he's been sort of sounding the alarm about this, and others have. And people thought, well, is he being alarmist? Is there really anything to worry about? And lately, really in the last 6 months or so, there's been a very explicit move, including by the head of a big telecom company, to say, of course, we should be able to charge for favored treatment. And this will lead to more deployment of broadband, because we'll have more incentives and we'll be making more money. And so, of course, if somebody wants to pay to get kind of premier billing, like maybe it's quicker to get to WashingtonPost.com than NewYorkTimes.com, if WashingtonPost.com wants to pay me for that, they should be able to, and we'll do that. Now, I'll tell you personally, I happen to think that's a terrible idea, and I think that would really distort a lot of what we take for granted on the web. And you think about it, I mean, I'm giving an example from the perspective of our business, but again, think about, you know, some individual. I mean, one of the glories of the web has been the kind of low barriers to entry and the kind of democracy of it. So, but there currently is a lot of debate about a possible bill in Congress, one way or the other, on this. And so that's really, I think, a very, very important issue to watch. Another one is the question of control of content and presentation of content. And I think this is going to come up more. You're going to see this in the next couple of years. And let me explain what I mean. So, WashingtonPost.com, we present articles. We spend a lot of time, our editors spend a lot of time thinking about that. Should they have a technorati box? What should they highlight as a link? What kinds of information should they suggest as possibly good related information? And they think of that as a very important function of a web editor, that with all this stuff out there in the web, it's very helpful to kind of have a trusted source for this, even though, as I say, with technorati, they'll put all the blogs there, but they're making the decisions on that. So let's say, and there are things going on, you know, like this to some extent, let's say Google or Yahoo, as part of their toolbar, has a function that automatically highlights certain terms and steers you to other places. Now, is that legitimate? Is that an interference with our control of our content? Is it an interference with our copyright? Is it a good thing? Does it matter whether it's something that you knowingly download or is kind of done for you? And what if it's something where it's not just them doing it by the links that they do, that they decide to do, but it's something that they put up for payment? So if there's an article about automobiles, they have an auction, and Ford or GM can have all kinds of links right there, you know, in the content that they're buying to highlight. Again, a very interesting issue. We're seeing some developments on it. I think that's going to heat up a lot in the next few years. One thing that's been a perennial issue is the question of jurisdiction. And that's been talked about since the beginning of the internet. And this is both state to state and internationally. State to state, there seems to have been a consensus that's emerged in the last few years, including a very important Fourth Circuit case, that you have to have, that there's a sliding scale, and if for minimum contacts, you have to have something more than just a passive presence on a website. Because what people were saying was, well, you put up a website, you know you're available anywhere, you should be able to be sued anywhere. In this Fourth Circuit case, there were a couple of Connecticut newspapers that did an article about prison conditions in Virginia and about the Virginia warden. And the Virginia warden then wanted to sue them in Virginia. And these Connecticut newspapers had done nothing to target Virginia at all. And the Fourth Circuit said, and there's kind of a consensus at this point, that if you just have a passive website, that's not enough to incur jurisdiction. You have to do something more. But internationally, many countries have been very aggressive about jurisdiction and have been asserting jurisdiction. And for media companies, this is especially important because the United States unquestionably has the most favorable libel and defamation laws and other kinds of media protection for media companies. And although jurisdiction and the choice of law don't have to be exactly the same, frequently they'll run together and there are the other burdens of jurisdiction. And there was a famous case with Dow Jones in Australia. There have been other cases. Now, the ultimate case in this actually involved the Washington Post. And this was almost like a ridiculous hypothetical that somebody would have said. That the Post in the late 90s wrote a story about a UN official who was from Africa. And that there were allegations of corruption about him. He had absolutely no connection to Canada. About 3 years later, he moved to Canada. He then filed suit against the Post in the Canadian courts, claiming internet jurisdiction. And the initial trial court found there was jurisdiction, even though, and remember with the WashingtonPost.com articles, after a certain period of time, it used to be 14 days, now it's 60 days, it goes behind a paywall, so you have to pay in order to download it. Even though there had only been exactly one download of this article since it had gone behind the paywall, and that was by the guy's lawyer. And he hadn't lived there at the time, no connection, and the trial court said, well, you know, the internet, of course they expect it to be available in Canada, it's not unfair to make them stand for trial here. And in any case, a big media company like the Washington Post probably has insurance to cover it, so we're not worried about it. But yeah, I mean, and it was really by far the most extreme. It was the, you know, kind of parade of horribles that you always hear about right there. And we filed an appeal, and we had a coalition of about 60 media and internet companies as amici. And the appellate court in Canada reversed a couple months ago and actually said it wasn't a close case, it wasn't a hard case under settled cases, under their settled principles of jurisdiction. There is an appeal to the Canadian Supreme Court on that, but as I say, many people thought it was a kind of settled application. But that was the first big international court that sort of went the other way on these expansive jurisdiction questions. Another legal issue that has come up a lot is the question of fair use in copyright. You know, what is fair use? That means it's not a copyright infringement. There's a big case against Google right now by a lot of authors and publishers because Google is scanning it without permission of the authors or publishers, is copying and digitizing every book. Every book that it can find, and then it's going to have a search engine that searches them. And Google says, well, we're not giving away the books. We're just copying it for purposes of the search. They're saying that's an unauthorized copy under copyright. It's an example of one of the issues with fair use, but there are many that are out there. And let's see, I do want to open it up for questions. I just want to say one thing about the quality journalism, and you know, this is where I'm coming from on this. I don't know if you saw the Edward R. Murrow movie was Good Night, Good Luck. And you know, there's this famous speech that he gave to the TV broadcasters in the late 50s where he said, If you don't have quality content, a television is just a box of wires. And I think the same thing is true of the internet, the same thing is true of computers. And I want to tell you about a conversation I had pretty soon after I became publisher of Slate, which has really kind of stuck with me. And it's actually why these journalism issues and the business issues are very closely intertwined. The guy who was then the publisher of The New Yorker and I were talking, and people sometimes refer to Slate as the New Yorker of the web. And he had been very successful with The New Yorker, where it had been unprofitable for a long time, and in the last several years it's been very profitable. He's done a great job of turning it around. And he was saying this about Slate, but he said he thought it was very important to the future of quality journalism that a place like The New Yorker succeed financially. And that it would actually be very unfortunate and even a tragedy if the view was, well, yeah, The New Yorker, that was, they did great stuff, but, you know, you couldn't really make it, you know, as a business proposition with something like that. Quality doesn't sell. And he felt very strongly that Slate was in the same position and that it was very important for Slate to succeed financially for exactly the same reason, to show that quality journalism on the internet, it's not just, you know, great to read, but it's also something that can really work, that can really support itself. And I feel that way about quality journalism generally on the web, that right now is a time where there are very fundamental questions, just like there were about TV in the 50s, about the future of the medium, the character of the medium, the kinds of contributions that it can make. And I think, although there's a tendency sometimes to separate the journalism issues from the business issues, I think they're really very entwined when you think about the future of the medium. So with that, I'd love to open it up if anybody has any questions or comments. Yeah?
If you've got a loyal Washington Post reader who comes in every morning to your website, and they just basically look at what you show them, so you sort of own their eyeballs. There's another kind of user who reads maybe their favorite blogs and follows a link once in a while that occasionally comes to WAPO. And then they go back and see what their blogger said about it, pro or con. So the one set of eyeballs you kind of own, the other set you kind of don't own. And I'm sure you've looked at the click patterns really carefully for your 15 million users. How does it sort of break down?
Well, it's very interesting. I mean, and it's a great point because, you know, I was saying that 85% of the users come from outside the DC region. But many of those come in, as you say, through individual article pages rather than through the homepage. And I have to say, our conversion rate in terms of kind of getting them into multiple pages is not what it should be. I mean, and it's something we spend a lot of time thinking about. I recently saw, I pulled figures on our three biggest states outside the DC region for WashingtonPost.com to look at the pattern of where people went. So, and those are California, New York, and Texas. And there were probably maybe a third saw the homepage at some point in their visit. That was actually more than people suspected in terms of our impression. But it also illustrated, you know, two-thirds of them. Now, that's not necessarily entry points. If somebody went to the homepage and then went someplace else, that's counted in that two-thirds when they went someplace else. But definitely the majority, and we know, you know, whether it's from Google searches or links on blogs or, you know, anything else, we know there are lots of people who come into article pages. And it's actually a great point about the difference between the online medium and the print medium, because again, with the physical newspaper, you do kind of control somebody's mode of entry more. I mean, sure, somebody can just pull out the sports section, or they can not really read the front page, you know, and that kind of thing, but not nearly to the extent of the internet. And it's an issue for us. I mean, and it's something that I don't think we or other sites are doing nearly enough to figure out. We haven't figured that one out yet. You see little things. Like one thing that the New York Times has done in the last several months, which I think is actually very smart, is that if you're in a particular section, at the bottom of the story, it'll say something like, this is number 4 of 9 articles in business, you know, or something like that, to try to drive you to the other articles. But, you know, we have, you know, Related and Slate boxes, you know, I mean, it's something that we're tinkering with, but I don't think anybody has quite figured out exactly the right thing. And there are huge gains to us if we could figure it out. Yeah.
Notwithstanding your last comment about that journalism issues and the business issues are more aligned than people might think, I imagine there's also a lot of conflict, particularly with sort of editors wanting to maintain pure editorial objectivity and publishers who want to, you know, maximize revenue with respect to strategic partners, things like that. How much is that sort of strict wall between the two sides of the publication adhere to online versus in print? And particularly for online-only publications, do you think it's harder to maintain that type of discipline?
Well, I think that, and, you know, everybody talks about that as the separation of church and state, you know, and that, too, is a very big issue. And I do think there are some issues that uniquely come up in online for a few different reasons, because the medium is newer, because it's a more flexible medium, and there are lots of different things that you can do. You know, the bedrock is that editorial decisions are not shaped by the kind of business side, by the particular advertisers or anything like that. I mean, I have the luxury of being at a company where that's so well established and so well ingrained that nobody ever questions that kind of fundamental principle. But you know, sometimes you can get into questions about perception issues with regard to that. So first of all, I think it's an important issue. Realistically, on a day-to-day basis, nobody challenges the premise where I work, so it's not something we have to kind of fight out in terms of the underlying premise. But there are issues that come up with it, you know. Just to take one example, political advertising online, which we've seen a little bit of. I actually think that the political world is way behind the corporate world in terms of understanding advertising online, which is a little bit surprising. You know, the selling of the president in 1968, it was conventional wisdom that the smart people in politics immediately followed what was successful in corporate advertising. There's a huge lag right now. Could talk about that for a long time if you want. But a question comes up, and frankly, different sites have different policies on this. Because you can target to content, if you're Joe Smith versus Jane Jones in that campaign, can either the Smith campaign or the Jones campaign, can they advertise in the politics area? Can they target according to whether an ad on a page that talks about their race? How prominent is it? Jarring if you're reading an article about that race and you have ads for those candidates? Those kinds of issues are discussed at length, and there are, you know, similar kinds of issues on the corporate side. So in terms on the corporate advertising side, so in terms of kind of the perception, I mean that definitely comes up a lot. And as I say, I think in terms of the medium, both because the medium is new, because it needs to establish itself from a business perspective, and because there's a lot of flexible things you can do with the page, those issues do definitely do come up. Yeah.
Washington Post and WashingtonPost.com are different or one entity. I didn't think about this until the Frumkin event was going on, and there was pressure on the online world from the print paper, but the web editors stuck by him, right?
Right, yes.
The title of the column?
Yes. Another great question. And let me talk about it in terms of content and in terms of structure. And it's something that has gone through a lot of different iterations over time. But the Frumkin incident, which is a very interesting episode, there is a web-only column called White House Briefing by a guy named Dan Frumkin, who covers the White House, and just on WashingtonPost.com, and he basically he comments, and usually fairly critically, about Scott McClellan's White House press briefings, and he's very scathing, and it's in the opinions section on WashingtonPost.com, and he's got a very big readership. A lot of people have discovered Dan and his column and like it a lot. So one of the things that spilled into the public discourse on this is that some of the Washington Post newspaper editors, including the politics editor, thought that it was a confusing, or could be confusing to users, because the name White House Briefing suggested it was the Washington Post's authoritative take on the White House. And so they would be misled and wouldn't really understand what it was. And this led then to a very active debate among Washington Post editors and on the blogs. And it actually surfaced some interesting issues about kind of, you know, print and online. And as was said, I mean, the executive editor of WashingtonPost.com, Jim Brady, said it's in the opinion section. It's an opinion piece. And it continues to have the name White House Briefing. In terms of the relationship between the newspaper and WashingtonPost.com in terms of content, on WashingtonPost.com, we have all of the content that's in the newspaper, plus a lot more. There's original web content in the form of columns. There's the multimedia things that I was talking about. Some of the content that's on WashingtonPost.com, a lot of it that's web only, comes from Washington Post reporters, and a lot of it doesn't. It's both. One of the things that I think anybody will tell you in the last several years, there's been a radical change in the perspective of the Washington Post reporters, where it used to be more difficult to get them to write for the web, and they now see that as an integral part of what they do, of kind of getting the message out. They realize it's read all over the country, all over the world. There are a lot of advantages in terms of the speed and interactivity and participating in the kind of raging debate that's going on out there. So in general, the Washington Post newsroom is far more engaged with the whole enterprise of the website and providing content to it than it, you know, than would have been the case previously. Structurally, there's also a couple things that the Washington Post newspaper did, which is that a couple years ago, which have been very, very helpful. You know, the way a newspaper is structured, there are assistant managing editors that control different areas, assistant managing editor for national, for the local metro. They created a position, assistant managing editor for continuous news, which is an interesting concept in and of itself. It was really responsible for keeping an eye on the web and being kind of the closest partner for the WashingtonPost.com editors in terms of getting things up on the site. And there also are a couple people, very experienced reporters. I was mentioning Fred Barbash, and there's somebody else, whose sole job in the Washington Post newsroom is to be kind of posting things online. And so there's a lot of things that have been done along those lines. You know, in terms of structure, I mean, I will say there's been a lot going on at other companies. The New York Times rolled up its website into New York Times Digital. Used to be totally separate. It's now been rolled up more generally into the New York Times. We are a separate subsidiary. It's a kind of, you know, sibling relationship right now. Very, very close partners. And that's, you know, that's the kind of management structure that, you know, at least for right now, the Washington Post Company thinks is best. But in terms of the whole kind of content side and the thinking about the site and that kind of thing, there's a tremendous amount going on there.
Better call this to a halt, and thank Cliff very much.
Sure, my pleasure.